Good afternoon. Thousands of protesters have again flooded Melbourne CBD, rallying against the Premier's proposed pandemic laws. Let's go live now to Mark Santomartino. Mark, they want the bill to be thrown out.
That's right, Alicia. We've heard the same sentiment. Kill the bill for weeks on end. Now, last Saturday, they promised they'd be back in even greater numbers. And that's exactly what happened. On the ground, it felt like there were tens of thousands of people there today, swelling at its most concentrated, as you're seeing on screen, to swallow up pretty much every single part of the road from Spring Street for blocks and blocks and blocks down Bourke Street. These protesters came from almost every angle. They started some on the steps of the State Library, others at Birrung Ma, others on the steps of State Parliament itself. But after a few hours, even during the rain, once they culminated at the steps of State Parliament, it certainly felt like one of the biggest protests we've seen in this city for quite some time. In the past few weeks, what we've largely been hearing has been protests against the vaccine mandate. As the numbers swelled today, it felt like that message was diluted more so by those who, from what we spoke to, were more concerned about those proposed pandemic laws, which of course would shift the power of responsibility for declaring a pandemic from the Chief Health Officer to the Premier. We spoke to a number of people in the crowd. Here's what they had to say.
What they're trying to do is usurp the powers, the laws which most people follow. So we are here to show that there's going to be opposition to it.
If this bill is not killed, this end of democracy in Victoria.
Business is already hard enough as it is without having these political rocks thrown in their road.
Craig Kelly and Bernie Finn were among those who spoke to the crowd today, both campaigning to kill the bill. Craig Kelly appearing a little bit confused as to referring to the Premier of the nation. But generally speaking, politicians on the right side of politics, the Liberals as well as the Liberal Democrats. We heard from David Limbrick as well in the crowd, who was just there as a civilian, not speaking today. They are campaigning to see some amendments passed when this faces the upper house.
You are coming after the Labor and the Liberal parties because you cannot trust them.
We have all had a gutful. We've all had a gutful.
This is really important legislation. It's gone through extensive consultation with the health experts, with human rights experts.
We know that this bill has already passed the lower house. It is set to be debated in the upper house this week, but the opposition says they won't grant any special leave to make sure that it is properly scrutinised.
All right, Mark Santomartino, thank you. We have breaking news for you now, and two people have been rescued from a four-wheel drive that was trapped in floodwaters in Melbourne southwest. The pair was found stranded inside the Toyota Prado at Williamstown North. Police search and rescue were quickly on scene, freeing them from the fast-moving water. It comes as heavy rain sparked major flood warnings and caused power outages for parts of the state. Reid Butler has more.
Well, Victoria's run of bad weather is just getting worse. This is a creek in the western suburbs of Melbourne. It's broken its banks, and that is actually a bridge, not that you would know it. It's been swallowed by the water. The western and inner western suburbs have been soaked.
Oh, it's very high today. It's absolutely massive. Poor dog can't even go down a walking track.
Drivers warned to be wary of flooded roads.
So those areas actually saw widespread 20 to 40 millimetres overnight. We saw 40 up towards Sunbury, and we saw generally 25 to 35 millimetres from Geelong all the way through to the airport.
Parts of the Gippsland region copped a month's worth of rain in one day. A major flood warning was issued for the Mitchell River at Bairnsdale.
In the 24 hours to 9 o'clock this morning, we've seen widespread areas of 50 to 100 millimetres of rainfall from around Traralgon all the way through to Mallacoota and up toward the ranges.
As many as 1,000 homes lost power because of strong winds and trees down.
We absolutely understand that this has been a terrible number of months for you. The government is working with the power businesses.
It's also been cold, really cold, for this time of year in Victoria.
I'm normally wearing shorts the last 2 or 3 weeks. This is the first time I'm wearing pants.
The SES has responded to more than 350 calls for help, mainly for trees down and flooding.
Queensland will reopen its borders from tomorrow, with the state due to reach the 70% double jab milestone. Travellers from hotspot areas such as Melbourne and Sydney will be allowed to enter the state via air but must quarantine at home for 14 days. Meantime, more than 87% of Victorians are now double jabbed, but there are still concerns about outbreaks at schools, with more than 3,000 children aged under 9 infected. Teenagers, however, continue to turn up in droves to get vaccinated.
The population that know that, hey, we want to come in and get this done and we support it, and then we can get back with our lives and we can protect our families, we can protect our communities, we can protect ourselves from getting COVID.
Four further Victorians have died from the virus, along with more than 1,200 new cases in the past 24 hours. Rock climbing, zip lining and brand new hikes will be the adventure pack draw cards for a brand new eco park on the edge of the Blue Mountains. As Lauren Tomasi explains, the tourism boost comes hand in hand with new environmental protections.
This will be the home among the gum trees for the state's new eco park. More than 30,000 hectares of state forests transformed into a conservation area and turned into a new go-to adventure destination. Located just north of Lithgow, this area boasts ancient pagodas and incredible views. It's hoped once complete, the site will draw in huge numbers of tourists to rival that of the Three Sisters in Katoomba. The centrepiece of the park will be the country's longest zip line at almost 1 kilometre in length. It will extend from one side of the valley to the other. If that's a little too adventurous, there'll also be elevated walkways across the canyons to take in the view. Walking trails, upgraded lookouts, four-wheel drive circuits and bike trails are also in the plans, worth $50 million.
Our great treasures shouldn't be hidden away. They should be on display for everybody to enjoy.
While the tourist aspect will bring in welcome dollars and jobs to the local economy, the wildlife here will also be looked after by new legislation.
This place is a haven for so many threatened species. Koalas, quolls, region honeyeaters, up to 80 threatened species.
This eco park is expected to bring in around 200,000 visitors each year. It will open up come January 2023.
The Global Climate Summit has gone into extra time as almost 200 countries try to reach a consensus on how to tackle climate change. As Jonathan Kersley reports, the Australian government's modelling behind its net zero by 2050 pledge has not been warmly received.
In Glasgow, the talks are continuing amid much shouting on the streets. Draft text of a proposed agreement has been watered down, and developing island nations at greater risk from the impacts of global warming have urged bigger nations to do more. UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson says that means they want to see more cash on the table amid concerns the summit could fail to deliver. Scott Morrison laid out his net zero by 2050 plan in Glasgow and yesterday put his modelling on the table, information criticised by climate campaigners and the Labor Party for lacking detail.
The modelling the government has commissioned there is not worth the paper it's written on.
This government can't be trusted on climate change.
The government says it's now over to the Labor Party to release its climate policy, and with an election due next year, the coalition is considering extending the low and middle income tax offset, which is due to end in June. That would mean workers pocket up to $1,080 for not just this financial year, but next.
We will continue to explore every opportunity to keep taxes as low as possible, including when we come to looking at the next budget.
And with the election looming, you can take to the bank. There will be more cash splashed.
It took a Los Angeles judge just an hour to dissolve the restrictive conservatorship that controlled Britney Spears' personal affairs and her fortune for more than a third of her life. Our US correspondent Alison Petrasky was there.
After 13 years, Britney Spears is finally a free woman. Judge Brenda Penny ruling to end the conservatorship that controlled her personal life and her $80 million estate. Britney tweeting her elation, "I love my fans so much, it's crazy. I think I'm going to cry the rest of the day. Best day ever." Britney's fans partied in the streets of downtown LA.
After 13 years of this abusive conservatorship, it's about time for her to live her life.
Shocked, stunned, relieved.
This is the best news that could have came out of today.
Britney's lawyer, former federal prosecutor Matthew Rosengart, said he was proud of her for shining a light not only on her conservatorship, but conservatorships in general.
If this happened to Britney, it can happen to anybody.
Matthew Rosengart has not ruled out a future investigation into Britney's father, Jamie Spears.
It could be days before a Perth family is rescued after becoming stranded in the South Australian outback following flash flooding. Maritime authorities launched emergency action yesterday, dropping supplies to them in the Simpson Desert by air. The family of four was travelling in a large camping vehicle. South Australia police are coordinating the rescue and will recover them when the weather clears. Detectives believe the killer of missing couple Russell Hill and Carol Clay may have tried to blow up the crime scene in Victoria's High Country. A charred gas cylinder was uncovered at the Wanangatik Valley camping site, which police suspect was set alight in an attempt to cover up evidence. Russell and Carol have been missing since March last year.